Okay, good evening, everybody, and welcome to the March 14, 2023 Board of Education meeting for Arlington Heights School District 25. Lana, if you could please call the roll to begin our meeting.
Member Conley?
Here.
Member Sciniglia?
Here.
Member Jogi?
Here.
Member Scapolato?
Here.
Member Filipek?
Here.
Okay, thank you, Lana. If we could please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, everybody, and I hope you're all comfortable. The Board of Education is always pleased to recognize students, and so we're excited to kick off our board meeting with recognitions and presentations. We always like to recognize our students, staff, and community members who help make District 25 the great place that it is. Tonight, we will recognize students who participated at various state tournaments. First are the students that qualified for the state wrestling tournament from both South and Thomas Middle School.
Thank you. I don't know if our principals from South and Thomas are here or our coaches, and if you'd like to say anything, come on up and say anything before we read off students' names.
Say a couple things. I need to sit here. I don't have anything prepared, but I just appreciate the opportunity to be here. We've been doing this now together 5 years, so we've really come a long way. This was our, as a district and as a school, it was our best season ever. We qualify with 6 kids total.
7, including South.
Six from my school, 7 total. That's district record, school record. It was incredible to watch. I know you got us started on this trip. I just also wanted to say too, for besides the kids who are here, you guys are going to get individually recognized, and they deserve all, you know, the accolades and everything. It's a 5-month season. It's a lot to go through for the kids and for the parents, so we really appreciate all the support, and for the school and for you guys. But I just want to say too, for the kids that aren't here, like what a great opportunity wrestling is. It's for those kids for those 5 months. It's probably their best time at school. So thank you for that. That's all I got. Appreciate your hard work, guys.
And absolutely. And I just want to voice some gratitude up here while we're here. I want to thank the wrestlers that put in so much hard work this season, not just the ones that qualified, but the ones that helped them get there. I want to thank the administration, Dr. Bine, Dr. Morrison, Dr. Perkins, for supporting the teams and helping us get there. I want to thank Coach Birdie for helping me too, but the parents too. Like it takes a group effort. It takes the village, and this is a sport in particular where it takes everybody to help get that one kid to the place that they get, and that's it's so much work. It was so much work for so many people to put into it, and I am just blown away by what that looks like when we all get there. So thank you.
Thank you to our coaches. And then Dr. Jogi and I are going to come around and call up students individually. The board has a small token of congratulations and appreciation for you. Teacher, he was like, Lori, you got to come see wrestling. I'm like, ew, I'm not going to go see wrestling. But my students were like, no, come on, come on. And it was the most amazing experience I had in seeing that wrestling really creates a community, that students, no matter your size, your grade, your gender, that you create a team together, that you, watching you appreciate your coaches and the other team's coaches, it really is an amazing sport to be a part of. So thank you for our coaches for making it a reality here, for our board for supporting this as a new sport that we just piloted 5 years ago, to families for all that you do, and students for putting forth great effort and really being great role models for your peers as well. So we'd like to call up those who have qualified for state this year. Again, Dr. Jogi and the board have a small appreciation for you. Our first ever state qualifier from South Middle School, Carlo DeFalco. Our state qualifiers from Thomas Middle School, Diego Arceo. Nicholas Clint. Joey Goduto. Anthony Klegis. Stone McComb. And Owen Pham. All right. Thank you again to our wrestling students, families, and coaches. We appreciate you. Congratulations.
I can't believe it's already been 5 years. It's incredible, and we're so proud of you, and this is fantastic. Next, we're going to have the South Middle School 7th grade girls volleyball team that participated in the state tournament.
And we'd like to welcome their coaches, Sophia Vassos, Chris Fano. Come on up. You have a presentation you want to do?
I do.
Okay.
I do. Right now. Sure.
Okay.
Is everyone sits now?
Yes, please. Okay. Yes.
Okay. Okay. Hi. Hello, everyone. Well, even though it's kind of weird with all them behind, so hello, good evening. So even though the people that have already gotten up here and spoken have already addressed all of the people who that they'd like to appreciate, I can't say it enough, and that was kind of part of what I wanted to say this evening. Number one, to the parents. Sure, the girls put in all the hard work, but parents, you are, you know, putting forth so much time, effort, finances, everything to support your children. There's no way that our kids are going to get as far as they can in the programs, in the volleyball programs as they do, without them really having that support and having that background. And they can only have that by the support of their parents. So kudos to you, parents. Thank you so much for getting them involved. Yeah, all the time, effort, money, all the traveling, all the everything that you do. Volleyball is the shortest of the seasons, and of the IESA seasons. We're a 2-month season from when we start till the state. So there's a lot to do in those two months. And again, they need the background, they need the foundation. And our 7th grade team this year definitely came with that foundation. So I knew they were going to be good at tryouts. I looked at them and I said, oh my gosh, and I've been doing this 23 years now. And I looked at them at tryouts and I said, oh my gosh, we've got a winner here. And I knew it. I knew it. I knew it took that teamwork, though. It would take them all to work hard and to gel, and they did. And so for that, I'm very grateful. To the board, thank you so much, because it really does, and our administration, it takes a lot for the programs to run. It takes a lot of finances. It takes a lot of, as our administration knows, a lot of hours, after school hours, evening hours, weekend hours, to run our program, and they're there for us, and we're very, very grateful. And I don't take that for granted, not one bit. And then finally, the girls. Girls, my goodness, you blew me away this year. We did end up with a record of 19-2. The thing that was the most, you know, out of all of the wins, you can say, oh, that was great. You know, we came in second at that Bolingbrook tournament. We had a very limited squad. We won our sweetheart tournament. We won our regional. We won sectionals. And you think to yourself, wow, all of those games, those are the ones that stand out. But I'll tell you, the one that stands out the most was our second game downstate. We won the first game, which put us into the trophy round. We knew we were going to get top four. And we came back that next morning, and we won the first set. We lost the second set pretty badly. I mean, they kind of, like, you know, had our number. But we battled back that third set. We did lose. And the way that they responded to me was just amazing. They never hung their heads. They weren't upset. They weren't, sure, they were a little disappointed, but they came together. And we came, you know, like 2 games later, we're back on that floor. They were having fun with each other, playing their tag, doing their things, getting warmed up. And they hit that floor ready for business. And we won that other game to secure third place. It's the very first time in Arlington High School history that we've received a trophy for the girls' volleyball. So they secured the first trophy in history. So I'm so super proud of all their character. And so I know that was long-winded, but this is my last one.
And I think we have a video.
Wow.
Thank you so much, Ms. Vasquez, for sharing that. You know, I am so thrilled just to see all the smiles and the excitement. And really, the story that you shared about responding to setbacks, that is incredible. And kudos to the students, because it's all about that resiliency, right? And it's all about bouncing back from setbacks. So we're so happy to hear that, and we're so happy to see all the triumph at the end as well.
And now we'd like to recognize students individually.
Okay, next we're going to move on to celebrate the Thomas 8th grade girls volleyball team who placed fifth at state. Thank you to their coach, Todd Slowinski.
All right, well, thank you for that warm welcome. So... I just want to kind of reiterate what the other coaches have said and say thank you to the board and to the district for your continued support. I especially want to, you know, thank you for the opportunity to continue competing in the IESA. I think it's a great postseason opportunity for our sports teams to be a part of, especially given that we're not part of a conference. Have some sort of competitive end of year tournament is really a great privilege. So thank you for that. Thank you to the parents for all of your continued support throughout the season. It's been a really great ride, and I know, like, just seeing some of the parents here and the girls, they've said that they missed the season already. And it was just really that special of a season that I think we kind of formed like a little community, and it was just really fun. Every time we had a game, I know everyone enjoyed watching this team play, and thank you to the parents. So kind of like Ms. Vasquez was saying, like, she at tryouts like knew this team was this good. I knew our team would be good, but I wasn't quite sure like if we would make it to state. And I think, you know, as the season went on, one of the things that I noticed about this team was how supportive they were of each other and how they just came together as a unit. And, you know, throughout the whole season, each and every one of them supported each other on and off the court. They all got along really well. they, you know, on game days toward the end of the season, I'd walk into the lunchroom and they'd all be sitting at the same table together in their green jerseys. So it was just really special to see them come along as a team. And I think it was that team mentality that really led to their success by the end of the season. So I'm really proud of this group. I know the result at state wasn't exactly what we wanted. You know, we lost our first game. We fought hard, and, you know, even after the loss, they held their heads high, and I think they were really proud of their accomplishments for the season. So, girls, I'm really proud of the season you were able to put together and all that you did, and I know that you're going to continue to go on to success in volleyball if you want to stay with it, but more importantly, I think you're all great girls that are going to go on to continued success in whatever you decide to do. So thank you for that, and good job.
So thank you, coaches, for sharing those videos with us. That is to give us a peek into all the excitement and the teamwork. And I love what you said, Coach, about how the team and the girls supported each other on and off the courts. That is so important, and the teamwork that you demonstrated. So, and I love the parents and the guests wearing the green sweatshirts too, incredible. So we are so excited and proud of you.
And now it's our pleasure to recognize our eighth grade girls volleyball members.
Madam President, on your way back, I noticed something unique in the crowd, which you're giving away all the student recognitions. Got the clickers, so if we all just give a good District 25 click, everybody got it. Maybe we're going to start a new tradition. They can stick around for the entire meeting. That'll be.
thank you so much, Scott. That was a great idea. Students, you are welcome to stay for the board meeting and see civic engagement in action, but you're welcome to go home and rest up as well. Thank you, parents and students, for attending. You're welcome.
Stop embarrassing me.
Do it as often as you can.
Whoa.
Yes. Yeah. It won't be as big of a deal. I'm
Wow, the wave of energy, very contagious. We're so excited the students got to come today. We will move on with our agenda this evening, going to board communications. We'll wait for a couple of folks. I think they're trying to get in. Okay, welcome. So the first item on the agenda is board member updates. And do my colleagues have any updates for today that they'd like to share? Okay. Welcome. I actually do have one item to share this evening, and I wanted to, based on Robert's rules of order, I wanted to bring up a point of personal privilege with my colleagues today so that I can address a topic of individual significance, which is super important to me. It is heartwarming that this past weekend, many members of our community celebrated Easter, Passover, and Ramadan, which all fell at the same time. Today actually is, in fact, the 20th day of Ramadan for Muslims around the world and right here in our district. During this month, one fasts from dawn to dusk without food or water, and it's a time of reflection, community, and giving. And I usually break my fast with a special dinner with my family and friends. But however, today, as the breaking fast time was just a few minutes ago at 7:30 during our board meeting, I am truly honored to break my fast with my District 25 family here today. I have placed dates at each of my board colleagues' tables, so feel free to enjoy some with me today as I break my fast. And once again, today and always, I am humbled to be part of this beautifully inclusive community. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Madam President.
Yes, Greg.
I don't have a personal or, a member update, but you know, people are at the core of what we do, and we all bring our personal experiences, whether we're students or teachers, but I just wanted to thank you for allowing us to share that moment with you. So thank you.
Thank you, Greg. Okay, we're now going to move on to Ed Red. Rich, Ed.
No updates
today. Rich and Stacy are not here today. Next, we have IASB, and I know we have some really great news that Greg is going to share with us.
Yes, Madam President.
Yes, Greg.
I am excited to share that at 4:27 p.m. this afternoon, we learned that our proposal to the to ISB, to the Share the Success panel, which is part of the joint annual conference, which is in November in 2023, we made a proposal with the title, the proposal was the Strategic Plan and Opportunity Roadmap for All Students. And we have been accepted to the Share the Success program. So what that means is this last year, Dr. Jogi, Dr. Kay, and myself presented at part of the carousel panels. And remind me, was it 20 minute segments? So we had a 20 minute presentation, and then we would do it multiple times, and different groups of people would come up. And it was really rewarding, a great experience, just for myself personally, because what we did is we took the strategic plan, we looked closely at the vision behind it, the process to develop it, and then what are the successes that are happening right now, today, in our district. And we packed that into 20 minutes, and we had such a great experience. We said, well, let's fill that out into an hour, bring some more of the, really put, flesh it out even more, and share that with our colleagues from around the state. And so pleased that we've been accepted. So
yeah.
Excited, very excited.
That is really exciting. And the reason why it's called Share the Success Panel, right, it's exactly that, because we truly learn from colleagues from across the state of Illinois. And this time we will be kind of, as far as our strategic plan that we're really proud of, sharing it with others so that they can learn from us and kind of learning from each other. So we're excited. Thank you, Greg, for all the hard work that you and Dr. Kay put in to put the proposal together for our board. So thank you for all that hard work.
Yeah, and it's really an honor, because we're up there and we're working as a team to put this presentation together, but we stand on the shoulders of giants, right? We're drawing from everything that's happening across the district. So it's an honor to do that.
Thank you. And as far as IASB, I feel like so much happens all the time. I can't recall if we had a fall division meeting at District 21. Was that like, I think, I can't remember if we talked about it already, but board members attended the fall division meeting at District 21, which are our neighbors right here. It was a really phenomenal meeting. They had us tour their buildings, and we learned from their district, and so it was good to be there, and we thank our partners at District 21. Other than that, let's move on to NSSEO, and Scott has some news for us too, right?
Yes. At our April 5th board meeting, we introduced Dr. Schnur to the NSSEO community, and everybody is very excited about what she's going to bring, and like I've been saying, carrying the torch of Dr. Hackett forward. Thank you to Anisha and Gina for showing up to that event. That was very inspiring for her to see how each member district is involved in NSSEO and how we are all dedicated to the success of our students who are participants of the NSSEO program. As we're all recovering from the 5K coming up on Saturday, on May 20th, the minor Roland Stroll from 3 to 5 p.m. will be taking place. So just about the time that you start feeling good again, we can hit it again. So that's May 20th from 3 to 5 at minor. It's the minor Roland Stroll. And I'm sure in future updates, as it gets closer, it will be celebrated even more. But keep that date open, because that'll be important for the students as well. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Scott. Definitely, let's put that on the calendar for any board members who want to attend. Lana, thanks for adding that to the calendar for us. And Scott, thank you so much for all the hard work that you put into the superintendent hiring for Dr. Schnur. We all got to meet her, and she seems remarkable. You had said it's big shoes to fill, and I believe you. There are so many similarities between the two, and I know she'll bring her own kind of leadership qualities too, but thank you for all your hard work with that.
My pleasure.
Okay. Moving on to community input. But as far as board member updates, let me just say one more. I don't know if it's going to come up again. So we have the ABC 25 Foundation run happening. We have the minor stroll that Scott just talked about. And then we also have, right this weekend on Sunday, Dr. Ben, we have the Special Olympics that our students...
Yep. Oh, yeah. The All-Star Track and Field Competition. The opening ceremony begins at 8. Competition begins, I believe, at 9. And that's at Prospect High School.
At Prospect High School. I'm sad I'm not going to be there. It's Alumni Moms Weekend this weekend, so I'll be with my sophomore at U of I. But I know my board members and colleagues will tell me all about it, so I'm so glad that that's happening right in our neighborhood, because last time we went up north, right? Mm-hmm. Thank you, Dr. Bine. Okay, moving on, we're going to go on to community input. And I will remind our guests today that the opportunity to speak to the board is provided for members of the public who have a comment to make about the business of the board. The board appreciates hearing from the stakeholders and values your thoughts and questions. As the board strives to make the best decisions for the district, public input can be helpful. In order for the board to reserve sufficient time to conduct its business and to operate its meetings in the spirit of civility and decorum, speakers are expected to follow these guidelines. Address the board only at the time provided on the agenda and only after being recognized by the board president. And identify yourself and be brief. Your comments must be limited to a maximum of 3 minutes. The board may shorten this allowed time in order to conserve time to allow the maximum number of people the opportunity to speak. And please be respectful and courteous. And the board requests that you not make any statements that are personally disrespectful or condescending to members of the board, and especially to our staff. The board typically does not respond to comments or attempt to answer questions during the public comment period, but we do listen intently and appreciate the input from our community. And as we've said, the blue sheets that you fill out have a space for email and phone number and your contact information. So if you fill that out, a member of our staff will get back to you, okay? So we'll start with Ms. Sheila Cruz.
Gender confusion from a Westgate School Library book, It Feels Good to Be Yourself. This is Ruthie. She's a transgender girl. That means when she was born, everyone thought she was a boy, but she grew older and older enough to tell her parents that she's actually a girl. And this is Ruthie's brother, Xavier. He is a cisgender boy. That means when Xavier was born, everyone thought he was a boy, and as he grew older, it turned out everyone was right. He was a boy. There are so many different ways to be a boy or a girl, too many to fit in this book. Non-binary is a helpful word that can describe a kid who doesn't feel exactly like a boy or a girl. Meet Alex. He is both a boy and a girl. When Alex was born, everyone thought Alex was a girl, but Alex is both a boy and a girl. This is Alex's gender identity. And he has a friend named JJ. JJ is neither a boy nor a girl. Ever since JJ was very little, they never felt exactly like a boy or a girl. They just felt like themselves. That's JJ's gender identity. Alex and JJ are non-binary, and just like there's so many boys and girls and ways to describe them, so many ways to describe the non-binary. And even with all these possible ways to be, some kids just don't feel any of the words they know fit them exactly right. Whether you feel like a boy, a girl, both, or neither, or if you describe yourself another way, that's your gender identity. Your gender identity might match what people thought of you when you were born, or it just might not. Because when you were little, your parents thought they knew what you were, but maybe they did, and maybe they didn't, and they could have got it right, or they could have got it wrong. In this case, when people guess wrong, it's okay to let them know. Ruthie was 5 years old when she told her parents they were wrong. "I know you think I'm a boy, but really, I feel like a girl." Oops, Ruthie's parents were wrong. She was a girl all along. The best part, you might feel like a boy, you might feel like a girl, you might feel like both boy and girl, or like neither. You might feel like your gender changes from day to day or from year to year. What kind of hooey is this? What kind of hooey is this that you'd put a book like this out for 6, 8, and 10-year-olds? Little kids do not care about another person's personality. They're not interested in dissecting each other's personality. They don't care. This is wrong and it's detrimental. A more appropriate title for this book might be Nonsense. Because you want to feel anything but confused after reading this book. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheila. Our next speaker today is William Boudreau. William, please join us. Thank you.
I'll start with the kindergarten costs, and I went back and I sent an email to Ms. Malik, who's not here, and I copied you, and you refused her the ability to answer my question when I spoke in February. I haven't gotten a response. I did copy you on that. But anyhow, going back to December 2021, it looked like the referendum in June of 2022. The narrative was, at least to those who didn't really see all of the information, was that we needed to spend $75 million to have full-day kindergarten. Yet that isn't true. In fact, in one of the slides that I saw, December 2021, all you need to do, you have extra space in the current elementary schools, all you need to do is increase classroom sizes, and you don't have to spend $50 million on additions to the 5 of the 6 or 6 of the 7 elementary schools. And in fact, if you did that, you would take about $700,000 out of the operating costs. Instead, in March of 2022, there's a slide that says, we're gonna do the 25 classrooms. Instead of taking $700,000 out, you're gonna add over $1.4 million, and that's a conservative estimate. And what you also did is you took option 3, which is, and I'd ask for this, $32 million to $42 million. That's the highest of all of the options that was available. And of the 25 classrooms that you're going to build, not one of them is going to be used for kindergarten. I'm sitting here in this particular school that's not being used as a school. So it would seem to me that if you really need additional space, why aren't you using this? I know this is for administrative offices. Well, right now, maybe you guys should put the brakes on the $50 million spending for the additions and think about opening this school if you really need it, rearranging the district boundaries for some of these schools. And there's two buildings down Arlington Heights Road. One's empty by the Guitar Center. The other one is across the street. And you could probably rent pretty cheaply office space for the administrative offices, which would save a lot of money. And in fact, based on the information that your demographer did, you only had 412 kindergarten students this year, which is 17 to 1. Right now, you're at a 19-to-1 student ratio. Even if you go up to 25, you would still have more than enough room in the existing buildings. And what's interesting is, on that 19-to-1 student-to-teacher ratio, you're not doing very well, because less than half of the students, when they leave 8th grade in District 25, aren't properly prepared for high school math and English, and that's your own slide. So it would seem to me maybe we need to put the kibosh on building the 25.
Thank you, Mr. Williams. Our next speaker is Kathleen Kuritz. Kathleen, if you could join us. Yes, Kathleen Kuritz.
Okay,
no, that's okay. Welcome.
Thank you so much. If you could just give me a second to sign back in again. Okay. Good evening. I am the niece of a retired and well-respected School District 25 teacher. She convinced me to move back to Arlington Heights and send my kids to School District 25 schools. My husband attended Dryden and South. My husband and I were raised in Arlington Heights. I have had children in School District 25 for the past 12 years. My family was nominated to be a We Are District 25 family to be posted in the hallway. I have been teaching special education for 23 years. I have a master's degree in curriculum and instruction, so I'm an expert. I have also taught and subbed in School District 25. I am currently teaching high school students who are transitioning from female to male. I care deeply for my students and have been told by students, parents, coworkers, and administration that I am doing an amazing job. My job is far from easy. I teach students who have schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, oppositional defiance disorder, autism, emotional disorders, and some are victims of trauma. I love my job. After a long day at work, I go home and care for my 6 beautiful children. My husband and I work very hard. I have been told that my children are amazing, kind, considerate, smart, intelligent, and hilarious. My children are 17, 16, 14, 12, 8, and 5. I have worked so hard to raise them. My older kids were the last to get cell phones. We did not give them open access to computers or television. We structured their free time. Instead, we drove them to practices, played games together, supervised them outside, or talked with them. We tried to monitor what they were reading. One of my older kids read so many books we could not keep up with him. One day I saw a change in him. He was acting differently and saying things a 5th grader should not be saying, in my opinion, as a professional. I don't know how to describe what I noticed other than he was no longer acting like my fun-loving child. I asked him if he was okay. He said he was okay. I continued to ask questions and realized he had been studying the Holocaust. His teacher was encouraging him to read book after book about history. I was so impressed by the amount of books he was reading, and then I realized he had read book after book about the Holocaust. My little 5th grader told me he had read about the Nazis using babies as target practice. He told me the Nazis tossed babies in the air and shot at them. I wanted to vomit. All those years of protecting my children's innocence was stripped. Certainly those books were not age appropriate. I did not call the teacher. I did not complain. I remained silent. I was afraid of causing friction. I didn't want the finger pointed at me. I learned my lesson. I cannot trust that School District 25 has the same values that I do. I cannot trust that books won't find their way into my children's hands. At the last board meeting, there was a book read from several School District 25 libraries. I remember a few lines about fingers in a child's genitals, pain with insertion, and it being related to a time when a neighbor fingered the child. As a teacher, I cannot help but imagine the book reports that might be shared in a classroom setting.
Thank you, Ms. Kathleen.
You're welcome.
Our next speaker is Kathy Joharan. Kathy, would you join us?
Haran?
Yes. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I don't have a lot prepared to talk about, but I watched the comments at the District 214 meeting, and I think our schools would better serve our children by teaching them to read and write and learn math. Leave the social issues at home. Bringing up our children's math and reading scores should be primary concern. We need academics to succeed in this world, and they need solid academics. I was really surprised when I saw some of the statistics from Wire Points, and they get their information from the Illinois State Board of Education and the Illinois Report Card. According to them, District 25 in 2021 had 45% of the students could read at their grade level, 48% could do math at grade level. Then they broke it down for third through eighth grade, third grade 39%, fourth 53%, fifth 49%, sixth 38%, eighth grade 42%. These kids are going to high school. Then I look at District 214, 42% of the kids can read and do math at their grade level. And then they break it down, white kids 56%, Hispanic 18%, black 17%, Asian 58%. 94% of the kids graduate high school, but only 42% of them can read at grade level. Some things gotta give if these kids, it's wonderful to see all the academics in them, I mean all the sports in them succeeding so well. The enthusiasm in the room was wonderful. But when we look at their math scores, their reading scores, something's got to happen, because these kids aren't going to succeed when they get out of school. Then I look at the school that we're partnering with, this District 88, and I pulled up their information. 8% of their students can read at grade level. Why are we partnering with a school that has reading levels that are like that? 5% can do math at their grade level. I don't understand. I think we need to forget the social issues, the books, the all of this stuff, and concentrate on math and reading and the basic academics that our kids need. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Ms. Elizabeth Pexosa. Welcome.
Okay, I am here today sharing because I feel as though this district turns a blind eye toward real issues happening in our community. As a board, you are more concerned with the infiltration of DEI, SEL, and soft CRT than the education of the next generation. Reflecting on your presentation of proficiency, you are well below average and with most grades below 50%. This is a failure. Providing a first-rate education is one of the most important gifts we can give to our children, and it's clear this district and board has lost sight of what matters and matters most and are leading the next generation into a downward spiral. The public schools in America are falling short, and our district is following suit. There has been report after report stating that school-aged children are slipping further and further each year but keep getting pushed to the next grade level. This is complete disservice, and it needs to be addressed. How many parents in this district do you think are actually aware right here in our community we are failing? Most parents want to believe and trust the board has the best interest of the children, but you are failing in its core educational mission. According to the most recent ISB annual report card, it states 214 has only 42% of students reading at grade level, 42 that can do math at grade level, but yet graduation rate is 94%, and teacher ratings are 99.8. These numbers do not match any logical sense. How are our teachers' ratings at excellent and proficient level when we are not even ranging above 50% proficiency? I have seen this firsthand in the lack of leadership. I have a third grader at Ivy, and we noticed her MAP scores at the beginning of the year were well below average. I immediately emailed her teacher to discuss extra practice at home that I was happy to participate in, but was told not to worry, she didn't need extra help. I was told most kids were behind as well, and it wasn't a reflection of her at school, and she would be just fine. Fast forward to conferences, I addressed again, seeing her struggle, and was told her reading level was below class average, but not to worry, she'll catch up. Her report card was again addressed and was told not to worry. By December, I had had enough watching my third grader struggle. I took her to a private tutoring facility where many other Ivy students attend to have her evaluated. She scored below her grade level and qualified for both math and reading tutoring. She's been in tutoring since mid-January, and at her last conferences in February is now all of a sudden qualified for reading intervention. All this could have been prevented had the teacher actually listened to my concerns. I would by no means give this teacher a great rating, and I know I'm not the only parent feeling this way. I've been told time and time again by the current superintendent that it's my choice to pursue private education, but that is not why we moved to this area or this district. I made it clear I wanted a great school district as part of my house hunt criteria, and here we are trying to find funds to give our children a better education with private school option. This is not a choice, but a deliberate push out. This isn't only my experience, but a list of 18 other families that I've found in D25's district alone that have been forced to make this decision from 2020 to the current school year. This was not a choice they made coming to this community, but a sacrifice they all had to make for their choice for their children. We need to do more and do better to make sure this next generation is successful, and as of right now, D25 214 is not showing any promise to that.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Sandra Bachar. Welcome.
Hello, everybody. I'm back to read another one of the books. To be quite honest with you, I feel uncomfortable reading these because I'm a middle-aged adult. So now I want you to picture an 11 to a 13-year-old girl or boy reading this or perhaps acting out this situation. Imagine it's your daughter or your daughter's friends. Please picture that. And it's a peeping Tom situation, and this girl is in her bedroom. "You know what I could use?" she asked. "A nice deep back massage." "You're evil," I whispered. She winked at me, then got up on her knees and worked her hands forward like a cat stretching until she was all the way down in my bed. Click, that's the camera. I straddled her back. Click, pushed her aside her hair, click, and began rubbing her shoulders, click, click. She turned away from the window and whispered, "You know what it means if he stops taking pictures, right?" I told her I didn't. "It means he's doing something else, click, what could that be?" She told me to follow her lead, then she rolled out from under my legs according to her plan when she said, "Three, I was to charge the window, but I thought the peeping Tom might have left, might have gotten scared because there hadn't been a click since I climbed off of her. It's time for some body lotion," she said. "Click. Okay, I can play this game," I thought. "Look at my top drawer." She pulled open the drawer, looked inside, and covered her mouth. "I didn't know you were into this. We should use it together. How many of these do you have? You are definitely a naughty girl. Click, click." "Oh my God," she screamed, "he's cramming his dick in his pants. This is disgusting. You pulled your fingers together and rubbed slow full circles around my stomach. Feels nice," you said. Your fingers made their way under my bra, but you didn't grab me, testing the boundaries, I guess, sliding your thumb along the underside of my breast. Does that kind of shit turn you on? "Just relax," he said, "everything will be okay." As if letting him finger me was going to cure all of my problems. But in the end, I never told you to get away, and you didn't. You stopped rubbing circles on my stomach. Instead, you rubbed back and forth gently along my waist, your pinky making its way under the top of my panties and rolled back and forth from hip to hip. Then another finger slipped below, pushing your pinky further down, brushing it through my hair. "And that's all you needed, Bryce." You started kissing my shoulder, my neck, sliding your fingers in and out. And then you kept going. You didn't stop there. "I'm sorry. Is this getting too graphic for some of you? Too bad." It's a little too graphic to imagine an 11 to 13-year-old reading this. Why are we doing this? Why is this acceptable? What is going wrong in society that any of you up there would think this is a good thing? We need to protect our children. Please, protect our children. This isn't about banning books. This is about saving the children from this demonic agenda. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you for the public comments. We will move on to communications from district partners. And for those of you who left from the comments that we had today, one of you left your contact information and you will be contacted. Thank you for providing that so we could follow up with you. So as far as communication from district partners, PTA is not here today. They're busy at work with everything that they're doing for our community. ABC 25, we have a report from our very own Gina Faso, kind of remotely.
Yeah, Gina sent her report on an ABC 25 update for the board. There is still time and for the community to sign up for the annual Get Burbed race happening this Saturday. Come join in our annual community fundraiser to support a great cause, our teachers, and innovation in classrooms. For more information, check out the ABC 25 social media, school newsletters, or their website. Hoping to see everyone there. The race kicks off from South Middle School.
Thanks, Lori. And DJ Scott will be there. Okay, thank you so much. The board, I have not been training. I will train between now and Saturday. So I will be walking. I'll be the caboose. Right. The board is looking forward to being there this Saturday to support our schools. Next up, we have ATA, Allison Berg.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you for the opportunity to allow me to share some exciting things going on in the district. I was also going to talk about the Special Olympics, so I'll do my little blurb as well. But this month, Windsor School is celebrating a Be Unique, Y-O-U-N-I-Q, with the theme Walk a Mile in My Shoes. And students are learning about different disabilities during their LMC time and through morning announcements. In art, students are creating or decorating a shoe, displaying their own strengths, and these will be on display at Windsor, so you can check them out if you are over at Windsor School. This Sunday, some of our District 25 students will be participating in the Special Olympics, which Dr. Bynum already talked about. Students will compete in a variety of events. Actually, I had the hours from 9:45 until 2. So if you would like to cheer on our student athletes over at Prospect, it is an awesome event. If you've never attended, it's a very cool event to attend, and our students are thrilled to have as many spectators and fans as possible in the stands, which is always nice to support. I am going to now shine the spotlight on Olive Mary Stitt. I think I was supposed to do something with an owl, but I don't remember what it was. Olive! Somebody's... Thank you. Okay, so happenings from the nest at Olive Mary Stitt. Kindergartners and fifth graders are loving working together as buddies. They enjoy playing games and reading books together. It's a good time for the fifth graders to be leaders and kinders to be learning from their older peers. There are some pictures of students in action. You're good. Thank you. Olive's first graders just finished their big trip to Japan. The kids are exposed to several different aspects of Japan and its culture during this unit. They explore the different islands that make up Japan and the cities like Tokyo, Osaka, and Kyoto. They are introduced to the life of a Japanese student, learning about the school day, Japanese characters and numbers. They learn about landmarks like the Imperial Palace and Mount Fuji, and they explore different popular cultural activities like the Cherry Blossom Festival, making origami, a traditional tea ceremony, and much more. This unit is a highlight of first grade at Olive, and I know I've talked about it before at board meetings, so it is something that Olive students, first grade students, look forward to every year. It's sort of a rite of passage if you're in first grade at Olive. Second graders are busy learning about presidents. They were able to apply those skills that they learned from their nonfiction reading and writing units while researching a U.S. president, and then they used that research to write a biography. They were assigned a president to research and then share what they learned. Some classes created a living museum where they dressed up as the president and presented to parents who come to view the museum. I especially like that picture with all of their wigs and dressed up as presidents. Very cute. Third graders love taking care of the earth in honor of Earth Day. And then last but not least, our fourth graders, another rite of passage if you are at Olive, the Iditarod is a dog sled race held in Alaska during the first 3 weeks of March. And this is a unit that the fourth grade teachers have created, which integrates grammar, vocabulary, life skills, spelling, math, science, and geography. It ends with an outdoor activity called the Idita Challenge, where students work together as a team to demonstrate their learning and have some fun. And it is a very
again, a rite of passage if you're a fourth grader at Olive School. So I'm happy to shine the spotlight and share some of the exciting activities going on. I will present from the last school, which I can't remember off the top of my head, at the next board meeting. So thank you again. Have a good night.
Thank you so much, Allison. Lots of exciting things happening. We love seeing and hearing about them. We will now move on to the consent agenda, and this is an action item. Can I have a motion, please?
Madam President?
Yes, Greg.
I move that the Board of Education approve those items on the consent agenda as follows. A, personnel report and addendum to personnel report. B, invoices. C, regular and closed session meeting minutes of March 14, 2023. D, superintendent professional development.
Thank you, Greg. Please, could I have a second? Second. Thank you, Chad. Chad beat you to it, Brad. Give me a quick on the trigger. Lana, could you please call the vote?
Cerniglia?
Yes.
Jogi?
Yes.
Scapolato?
Yes.
Filipek?
Yes.
Conley?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Next, we will be moving on to facilities management, and Ryan is all ready to go. So our director of facilities management will provide a construction update to the board. Hi, Ryan, welcome.
Good evening, thank you very much. Yeah, tonight I will be presenting a brief update on the Build 25 program regarding the full-day kindergarten program that will be coming to Arlington Heights School District 25 in the fall of 2024. First, I will be going over some renderings of the project, so I'd like to go through those on site-by-site basis and kind of give you an overview of where we're at with the renderings and the site layouts and the way the buildings will look going forward. The first site that we will be adding on to will be Dryden Elementary School. Again, we'll be adding on three new classrooms at this facility to support the full-day kindergarten program. Again, as we discussed before, these classrooms are going to be designed for K through 5 usage, so they may not be used for kindergarten classrooms right away, or they may be used for fifth grade. So just depending on how the building layout works, that these classrooms will be utilized. And again, we're building on to, again, add some capacity to the facility for program needs and also future enrollment buffers that may happen at the school facilities. So again, the first school is Dryden. We're primarily going to be building on to the south end of the school. As you can see in the red box, to the south end of the current school, we'll be taking over some of the asphalt play space that is already in the area. So we'll be resetting that and offsetting that area to the south once the building addition is completed. And then the further, the green, dark green box on the site is where our stormwater management will be housed underground. So we'll be managing stormwater for the site through an underground storage facility there that will offload into the village system slowly and to help prevent flooding in the area. So we will be putting more stormwater prevention facilities into this site. The general rendering again shows the new addition where the new line and the existing line kind of break. The existing is near the main entrance area. So again, the addition will be coming out to the south. We tried to blend together some of the aesthetics of the existing building and bring in some new modern features at this facility. So again, generally carrying through the design features of the facility and carrying them over to the new addition on the south end of the building. For Greenbrier Elementary School, again, two new classrooms. We'll be connecting, again, the existing older portion of the building that was built in the 1950s and 60s and tying it off to the addition that was done in 2017-2018. Again, this will create some flow to that side of the building in a small courtyard space. Again, so it'll be a one-story addition. This addition will be made so that a second story could go on in the future to this facility if it was needed, because otherwise at this site, we don't have a lot of space left. Again, just planning for the long-term future that this facility could accept two more classrooms on a second story if it was warranted. Again, primarily on the southwest kind of corner of the facility here, very minimal site disturbance here. Our stormwater will be housed in a detention facility that we have an agreement with the Park District already. So we have stormwater capacity. We have no other site disruptions to this site besides where the addition will be going here on the facility. And again, as you can see from the rendering, the elevation carries through very nicely and connects with the existing facility, and it'll kind of be a seamless look on that southwest elevation of the facility. For Olive Mary Stitt, again, we've been discussing this one for a while on where it needs to go. We are proposing and we will be putting it on the west side of the facility, closer to Arlington Heights Road. So as you can see from the renderings, it will have some elevation changes. You can kind of see the step in the drawings. That'll be the ground and the grade, so there'll be some stairs and some landscaping and things along that west side of the facility. This school will be doing the four classrooms, so primarily it'll be four classrooms and two smaller office spaces and breakout spaces at the facility. So again, we'll be coming over to the west. There'll be some new landscaping and things to enhance that side of the facility near Arlington Heights Road. So Olive Mary will primarily be that. There's a playground in the current existing location of this, a smaller playground that will be offsetting to the east side of the facility. As you can see, there's a smaller light red pinkish kind of rectangle on the plan there. The smaller location is where we'll be taking that playground from and relocating it over to the east side so we can maintain that playground structure. The structure will be salvaged, but we're going to maintain that structure. It can be reused, so we will be relocating it over to the east side of the facility. For Patton Elementary School, this will be three classrooms in the original design. It'll be tucked into the backside of the facility, kind of on the western side of the facility. It'll connect an addition that was done in the 2000s with a two-story addition on the north and back to a single-story addition, so it'll provide some flow from the current wing on the north end back to the commons and gym area. Again, at this facility, we're proposing three classrooms that can be constructed on in the future, a second story, so the design is made so that it could accept a second story in the future of another three classrooms. We'll also have two smaller breakout spaces in the interior of the facility and a small courtyard. I just want to remind you that we are also looking at the still working through the design of a gym expansion in this facility to support additional PE sections and make the gym expanded. We'll be going through that process with the Village of Arlington Heights, and I'll get into that a little bit later, but we will be bidding that as an alternate bid to the project so that we can discuss it when the bids come in and make the recommendation if we were going to move forward with that portion at that time once bids are approved for the project. But in general, the design carries through the typical brick that we have at the facility, some of the design cues that are throughout the facility as well. So we're looking to connect that together and again, improve flow on that side of the building as well. For Westgate, again, this is our biggest expansion. We're looking to do 10 classrooms at this facility, again, to support the program needs at the facility. The building is already full day kindergarten, and give this building some space into the future since the building is already at 100% capacity. So looking to add the 10 classrooms, the net increase of 10 classrooms, we'll be taking up three of the classrooms will be going in the existing gym, and then the remainder will be built in the new addition portion. And then we'll be constructing the new gymnasium, which is the higher portion shown in the rendering there. So the existing gym is towards the left side of that rendering where the three prominent windows are. So not the first window to the left, but the three windows kind of in the middle. That is where the existing gym is, where the higher roof section. So those will be classroom spaces, three classrooms built into there. A fourth classroom will be built new next to that existing gym space. So again, we're looking to add this addition next to the playground, the existing playground. We are anticipating there will be some disruption to the playground during the school year. We're intending to keep the playground, but during construction, due to the height of the wall and some of the logistics of getting to the playground for safety-wise, we're going to need to close down the playground structure. So we're working with the building administration on how we can accommodate the school through that period on where students will play. This occurs every once in a while where we need to do that, and we come up with alternative play areas and recess opportunities for the students while that playground is closed. If there's an opportunity at some point in construction where the safety concern is gone and we can open it back up, we'll be looking to do that as soon as we can. Again, the classroom addition comes down to the south and kind of carries through the design cues of Westgate as well with the stone top and the red brick facade. Finally is Windsor. Again, this is a single-story addition at the time. We'll be able to accept a second-story addition down the road if we need to because it is connecting to a second-story addition that was existing. Again, the addition that was put on in 2017 is furthest to the south, so we're looking to tie that back to the existing older portion of the building and provide, again, a loop and a flow of that side of the building. So the existing classroom on the far end of that wing right now will have a little bit better flow back into the commons and general office areas. Otherwise, again, this is a fairly limited site interruption project. We have an adequate stormwater for this site. So really, we're looking to put the two classrooms onto this site and have minimal site disruptions at Windsor School. Kind of a program overview just of general timeline and where we are at in the approval processes. We have full approval right now on Dryden, Olive, Patton, and Westgate. There are two sites that we have conditional approval that we're going to be seeking some clarifications and cleanup on in the next few weeks. There was just a clerical error in the posting that was made through the village, so we just need to go through that one more time to get the two steps finally approved. So again, we have had no concerns with those two projects in the concept or approval-wise. It's just that we want to make sure that we're adequately approved through the village process by going back and making sure that those are fully approved. As I discussed, the Patton Gym will be starting to have some community meetings and some outreach on that project as well. Also reaching out to the village to have some more meetings for conceptual design review, plan commission, and village board approval, just so we have that conditional approval so that if we do decide to go forward with the gym, that it's kind of ready to go in coordination with the other classroom section. So we will be looking to go through those steps with the village to make sure that we're kind of in lockstep with the other portion of the projects. For stormwater, we have a majority of the projects submitted for Village of Arlington Heights Engineering and going to MWRD review. So first, Village of Arlington Heights reviews the formal engineering plans for stormwater. We're in process of that. We anticipate some initial comments by the end of this week. So then once we have formal approval from the village, we'll go to the MWRD, which is the regional stormwater entity. They also have to sign off on a permit for these projects because they're larger construction type projects. So we'll, once we get the village portion done, we'll move on to MWRD and seek their approval as well for these projects in time for the summer groundbreaking and when construction starts. The Regional Office of Education, once we're a little bit further along in the process, we'll be bringing forward the building permits for board signature, and we'll submit those as well so they're ready to go for the projects. Again, we will submit those to the village, or sorry, to the regional office in time for construction to commence this summer. And then the preliminary site construction logistics plans, which shows where the fence is, where the trailer will go, kind of lay down area, and all that has been distributed to principals. We've gone through initial comments and working with our construction manager at this time to kind of lock those in for the summer on how those will be set up for the construction project. For bidding timeline, we've broken this up into essentially two packages. So bid issuance one is Olive, Dryden, Westgate, and Patton. And within that package, there'll be two base bids. So we broke that up further into Olive and Westgate and Dryden and Patton. So contractors will have the opportunity to bid on both those packages. But again, they'll be awarded, base bid one will be awarded to the lowest bidder per package for each one of those. And the same contractor could win base bid two as well if they're the lowest. There will not be a combined package, but they could essentially carry both those projects if they come in with a low bid on both those packages. So just to provide a little buffer and break up the packages, if a contractor believes it's too big of a scope for them, they can decide to bid on one or the other, or if they're comfortable with the scope, they can bid on both. So that gives a little bit of flexibility on the way contractors can approach their pricing and hopefully give us the best pricing for these projects going forward to make sure that the scope isn't too big for them or too small. So either way, it helps them out in that way. So again, the Patton Gym, we're going to be bidding as an add alternate. It is in the package that is going out. So again, that's an add. We would have to select yes to approve that. So we'll have the number for that and we'll be able to make the decision based on numbers overall and where we're at with the programming for that once the bids come in. We had a pre-bid meeting here on April 5th. We had 43 contractors. It was a great showing. And it had great coverage across the packages. So sometimes you get a little heavier on electrical or HVAC, but essentially we had four or five contractors for each one of the 10 packages. So it was good to see that we had good coverage for all the packages that were included, and we didn't have a shortfall on some of the areas. So again, it is a mandatory pre-bid meeting. We want to do that to make sure we vet out contractors from out of state or somebody might just throw in a bid. We want to make sure that they're serious about bidding our projects and that we know who they are when they come into the pre-bid meeting. We're intending to open bids right now on May 5th. We do have a number of addendums and issuances that will go out through this process. So if anything would change with that date, we would let you know that the date changed. But that does happen at times where we need to issue another drawing or there's additional clarifications that the contractors needs and the date needs to be pushed a little bit to accommodate that, right? We just want to make sure that we give them as much information as possible so that they can list competitive bids. And then after that, we'll do bid tabulations. We'll analyze all the bids. We'll review it with the contractor, and then we'll have our construction manager make a recommendation on who they recommend is the lowest responsible bidder for the packages that are out in the package. The second issuance will be Greenbrier and Windsor. Again, since those are smaller additions, those will be a little bit later. So the base bid for will be for Greenbrier and Windsor. We have a pre-bid meeting on May 17th, and right now the bid opening is scheduled for June 6th. And kind of the same set, we'll set up a meeting at some point down the road where we present the findings and make a recommendation on what contractors we'd recommend for that second issuance package. Just the preliminary construction timeline. So we believe that the first issuance package right now, Olive Mary Stitt, we're going to move up a little bit. Initially looking at, we were anticipating that Westgate and Dryden would kind of get going sooner. But just speaking with the construction manager and constructability-wise, just the Olive site is kind of tight. Even though it's not a large scope, we'd like to get out of that corner as much as possible before the school year, since it's close to Arlington Heights Road and Olive Street. So we're going to start at Olive as soon as possible in the summer. So as soon as school lets out, we're looking to break ground on the Olive addition to try to get out of the ground as much as possible before the school year comes, so we can have the majority of the site built before the school year would commence. Dryden, we're looking to mobilize in June and July, so we'll look to put the fence up at that time. There'll be some site work, there'll be some surveying work, some light engineering, there might be some site utilities being relocated, but major construction is not anticipated to commence until sometime in August at that site. So again, there'll be some lighter stuff going on the sites, kind of behind the scenes types of things that'll be occurring there until August. Westgate, again, similar setup. The site mobilization will be in June and July. With this site and Dryden, we kind of want to have the site kind of set up the way it will be for construction before school starts, just so we don't have to flip it on parents or students and staff, so that we're kind of set and get into the ways of the way the site will be for the next year or so, so they don't have to make changes consistently throughout the school year. So site mobilization, June and July, construction to commence again mid-August. Patton, we're looking to do the site mobilization same kind of time frame. This one will probably start a little bit further behind since it's not as much site impact as the other sites. So this one might be a little bit more in September, just to give us a little bit of buffer on how we're gonna phase out of that. So looking to get those sites going here in the near future this summer and early fall. The second issuance, again, for Greenbrier and Windsor, we're looking to do a mobilization in the late winter area. So starting to get the fence set up and the site mobilized for late winter, and then kind of an early spring start on those projects again, since they are two classrooms that are being added on to each of those sites. Other than that, we are looking to have the projects completed for the August 2024 start of the school year for full day kindergarten and also all the other students that will be coming into our doors. So that's a general overview and update on where we're at for the Build 25. Again, this is the addition project. We still do have some other packages that will be coming through for capital type projects. We have a site package that's out right now that we'll be bringing forward at a future board meeting, and maybe some other little ancillary projects that are also included in the referendum scope and scope they were intended to do. But again, this is the majority of the addition scope that we're talking through that you've already approved. Again, one of the other capital projects at one of the recent board meetings, you've approved the Westgate renovations and some of those other capital type renovation works. I'm open to any questions you may have.
Thank you so much, Ryan. Any questions or comments for Ryan?
Madam President?
Yes, Greg.
Ryan, just a simple question, and I imagine the answer is yes, of course, but if I could ask, you've always mentioned consistently when we are building these classrooms that they're ready to accept a second level, and it just occurred to me when you're talking about Patton, where it's adjacent to a second level, correct. Is it also ready to not only to build up, but to connect with a second level that's adjacent?
Yes, so the addition again would connect with the second story up on the north end. We would have to install a new stairwell on the south end of that addition. Okay. But the way the addition is being constructed, it's leaving space for that stair to be constructed on the south end of the new addition.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions for my colleagues? Ryan, first of all, I want to thank you. You know, as we continue to get questions from the community, just clarifying questions. Dr. Byrne, you've done a great job responding always. And you know, Ryan, I know you're providing information. So thank you for continuing to communicate comprehensively about kind of giving us those updates. So we have that and the community has that. I had a question. You know, for the buildings, you had said some are starting spring 2024.
Correct.
But we'll still be ready to go fall 2024.
Yeah, we've done a number of those. Windsor was the latest example of that. We started very late, and that was a very big addition, considering we had the gym expansion and, what was it, 6 or 7 classrooms. That was a really big undertaking with all the site work as well, so we're anticipating that the 2 classrooms is manageable, and that'll be good for the contractors to break up their work a little bit, and hopefully if they're awarded that package, that they can accept that and move into the next phase of their work. So yes.
Okay, thanks. And we know you're exceptional at what you do, so I know you have it all kind of laid out, but we're going to be ready for ribbon cutting 2024 for all of these, right? Thank you. Thank you so much. And I don't see any other questions.
Madam President.
Yes.
So, Ryan, thanks, obviously, for all the hard work. Nice summary of the expansion work. Can you give us a flavor in the near future of how the capital projects are going to overlay with? Because obviously we're doing a lot of that in conjunction.
So yeah, so the biggest one, again, was awarded, I believe, at the last board meeting, is the Westgate renovation. So mm-hmm. that work, again, is its own package. There's its own set of contractors. That doesn't necessarily mean at all that they could be on the addition work. So there'll be a set of contractors for the renovation work on the north half of Westgate. That'll primarily be from the commons area north. That'll take care of the renovation work in there. Again, ceilings, lighting, plumbing, some flooring scope and things like that. So the construction manager will manage that, right? They'll manage that scope of work. And then they also may have a separate set of contractors. There may be some overlap, but a separate set of contractors that may be doing the addition work there. So that is the biggest one this year. And then next year, we're looking to a lot of this scope, capital scope for air handler replacements or roofing work is included in this addition package, right? So we'll have that breakout as best we can on how that split is happening with the pricing, right? Is it capital work for the existing building, or is it addition scope solely for the new scope, right? So we'll have that broken out as best we can to show the separation in funds on how that works.
Awesome, thanks.
Okay, thank you so much, Ryan. We will now move on to an action item with Dr. K, with the personnel plan for 2023-2024. Can I have a motion, please?
Madam President.
Yes, Greg.
I move that the Board of Education approve the 2023-2024 personnel plan as presented.
Thank you. A second, please.
Second.
Thank you, Chad. Brian, if you could, Dr. K, if you could please provide the information on the personnel plan for the next school year.
I can, yes. Thank you, Board, and Dr. Bine, for allowing me to share with you the personnel plan for 23-24. These staffing projections are based on student enrollment projections, program needs, and mandated state programming, including student-identified needs and the goals of the district. So after extended conversations with building administrators and the cabinet, we are recommending the following changes for the 23-24 personnel plan. The additional positions that we are recommending, I will highlight an increase of 1.0 multilingual teachers to support the growing needs of our newcomers, an increase of a part-time classroom teacher based on anticipated enrollment, most likely a kindergarten section. In the area of special education, we have a number of increases that we are recommending. A part-time special ed resource teacher at Westgate, based on the number of students transitioning from the IS program into the resource level of support. A special education resource teacher at Windsor for the instructional program, growing by one section. To support that instructional program at Windsor, a part-time speech-language pathologist to support them, and three additional teaching assistants based on the enrollment needs at Windsor. In addition, a part-time social worker at Olive based on the increased caseload, and a part-time registered nurse at Westgate for a student who is currently part-time and will be going full-time next school year. Lastly, in the area of special education, we are requesting an increase of a part-time adaptive PE teacher and BCBA. Currently, we are contracting through NSSEO for both of those half positions. So what we'd like to try and do is post those positions so they can be our employees. If we can't find them, then we will continue to contract through NSSEO. In the area of administration, we are requesting an increase in the salary that we are currently offering the assistant to the Director of Food and Nutrition Services to make it a more competitive position when we are seeking a candidate. And we are also seeking an increase of a part-time assistant principal at Westgate to support the growing needs of the general education population and those at the school with specialized needs. Lastly, in the area of stipends for the Arlington Teachers Association, we are requesting an increase of 2 stipends per middle school to support the growing needs of the athletic and extracurricular programming. In addition to these recommendations, we will continue to budget a contingency amount to accommodate staffing needs that may arise due to unexpected enrollment changes or new students with special needs entering the school district. At this time, these are the recommendations that I am providing to the Board of Education for the personnel plan for 2023-2024 school year as presented. Are there any questions?
Thank you, Dr. K. Any questions for my colleagues? Dr. K outlined it very clearly. It's interesting to see, Dr. K, that you mentioned an increase in a multilingual population in needing, you know, so needing extra support and Teacher's Day. So thank you for kind of keeping a lookout for that. But seeing no other questions, Lana, could you please call for a vote?
Jogi?
Yes.
Scapalotto?
Yes.
Filipek?
Yes.
Conley?
Yes.
Cerniglia?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. K. We'll now move on to the superintendent's report with an update on our FOIA responses.
Thank you. The board has in front of them the Freedom of Information Act requests along with the dates that responses were provided. I believe all of these were from the month of March through April 5th.
Thank you, Dr. Bine. And our next item from Dr. Bine is regarding board meeting dates for the next school year.
Thank you. So I really just wanted to start getting some board input. So this is truly a draft. At the April 25th board meeting is when the board would determine dates for board meetings for the following school year. But in our past year, we needed a few meetings to kind of make sure we were all on the same page. So I wanted to put this out in front of you. So currently what we have drafted for the board are meeting dates that continue to fall on Tuesday evenings and with meetings, open session beginning at 7 p.m., closed session typically beginning at 6:15 p.m. before that. There are some dates that are really important for legal requirements on dates on how we set the budget and have time for public hearing. Same with the tax levy. So some of these dates are very strategically placed to make sure that we meet those legal timeline requests. Otherwise, I believe we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16 suggested dates on the calendar for next year. And we really kind of wanted to get the board's input to make sure, are we on the right track with Tuesday nights, or are there other things that the board would like us to consider? On the right are some notes for the board on when we might typically do those activities, but those wouldn't be part of the official meeting dates. It's just to give you something to think about when those larger activities occur.
Thanks, Dr. Vine. Any questions, comments from my colleagues? We're good. Hey, Dr. Vine, you know, sometimes, you know, we have one meeting a month and sometimes there's two. If you could kind of speak to that a little bit.
Sure, that's really just kind of District 25 history, to be honest with you. There are no required number of meetings that a school board must have, although typically it's at least one a month so that a district can process bills on time. And other than, again, dates, September, November, December, important for tax levy perspectives. The board could always decide to say we're gonna do one a month. Typically in District 25's history, we have, the board has requested that we have meetings there, and should we not need them, that we cancel them. But again, you don't have to do any certain number. We would request that there's one a month at least so that we could pay bills on time.
Yeah, no, of course. I'd like to applaud the board on, you know, our continued emphasis on being effective for the sake of our students. So one a month for sure, and if there's, you know, maybe we, so I'd like to maybe open it up for discussion to my board members, like, should we have the somewhere it's listed to, just in case we need them, and then scale back, or for effectiveness purposes, should we shoot for one a month to make sure we're getting our work done?
Madam President.
Yes,
Brian. I guess as we continue this conversation, because we probably would see at least two more before we'd even see a final calendar, right? How many more?
Typically, this would come to you at the next meeting.
Would it be the next
for
one?
Approval.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So I know we had two this month, so I wasn't sure if it would spill over the next month. I guess it's probably just something maybe each of us can individually pencil in, but it'd be helpful to know, even if it's just historically, what the major topics were on the, especially the two meeting months, right? I think we all agree that once a month is pretty much our cadence. So it'd be kind of helpful maybe just moving forward. I mean, personally, I as history has said, on the months where we have two, we have canceled if there, if one of them seems to be lighter or another thing. So I think it'd just be helpful to know what the main agenda items were on the two meeting months, if that makes sense.
I can definitely send that too.
Okay, thanks, Dr. Bryant. And then we want to be sure that our board meetings are accessible to our community. So District 214 has the board meetings meetings on Thursdays, correct? Not every Thursday, but Thursdays. And so, to me, it makes sense for us to have our meeting switch to Tuesday. My board colleagues, do you feel like that's good to go? Yeah, yes, I'm seeing heads nodding. Tuesdays sound good. Thank you, Dr. Mann. I don't see any other questions, comments about the calendar. So we will, thanks for bringing that to us for consideration to kind of confirm up by the 25th, the next board meeting. Our next item is from Dr. Bryant, is a student suspension review. And this is an action item. Can I have a motion, please?
Madam President.
Yes, Chad.
Recommend action of the Board of Education uphold the suspension of student 7TBP231.
I'll second.
Thank you, Chad. Thank you, Scott, for the second. Are there any questions, comments? And I have a comment.
I'll just share with the board, right, that this is a review where the board received a hearing officer report. They reviewed those documents because it is related to specific student. They reviewed those documents in closed session, but now in open session, the board is required to take action following that review of the documents presented by the third party hearing officer.
Thank you, Dr. Bynne. And on behalf of the Board of Education, I want to state that significant thought was given to this student suspension process, and that the board's decision for this hearing has been made with serious consideration and an understanding that all required procedures of due process were followed by the district. Ultimately, the goal for each student in our district is their continued growth and well-being. With that, Lana, can you please call the vote?
Scott Bellotto?
Yes.
Philip Peck?
Yes.
Conley?
Yes.
Cerniglia?
Yes.
Jogi?
Yes. Okay, moving forward. So I believe we are going to...
Letter D.
The first reading of policies. So a list of policies from Section 6 have already been reviewed by the Policy Committee. These are presented to the board for a first reading. Are there any questions or comments on these policies?
I'll just do a quick review. In front of you for continuing press section 110. The board's already reviewed much of 110. There are only three policies included here. Policies recommended by the policy committee are recommended upon unanimous vote unless notified here. So you will see 5:280 recommended by a majority of the policy, policy 650, and then policy 6:130 also recommended by the majority of the policy committee. As always, the board is able to see press updates in green and red, and then areas that are highlighted in blue are a combination of suggestions from administration, the board, attorney, or policy committee review members.
Thank you, Dr. Bynne. Are there any questions or comments on these policies? Okay, seeing none, We're going to, this first reading of policies for section 6, correct, Dr. Bine?
That's right. So the previous ones will come back to the board for a second reading. Now, on to first reading of policies for section 6, along with press updates, and the policy committee is reviewing sections of the policy manual throughout the year. This is section 6 on instruction. Again, these policies have already been reviewed by the policy committee and are brought forward upon recommendation by that committee. The recommendation is unanimous unless noted at the end of the policy, and you can see that for each policy. So there are several policies from section 6 here for first reading. Again, things that are highlighted in green and red are straight from IASB's Press Plus service. Items that are highlighted in blue are a combination of administrator, attorney, and policy member updates and suggestions.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Bine. Are there any questions on those that portion from colleagues? Thank you, and that kind of wraps up the policy portion of it. Chad, did you have a question?
Yeah, I mean, I know it was not unanimous, the library policy, so what was actually discussed from the non-unanimous perspective, just so I understand.
Yeah, so I'm just going to pull it in front of me. So policy 6230, library media program, was recommended by a majority of the policy committee, as noted. The areas in green are updates from press, from IASB, as a part of their press section 111, which just came out, but we went ahead and pulled this forward since the board has been discussing it. The other items from a member of the committee would be something that any of the policy committee members could share, any of their individual perspectives, so the board can hear if they had other perspectives. Again, I believe the person that may have had different ideas is not present right now, but could speak to that at the second reading as well.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions, comments? I want to state, as far as the policy committee, I truly applaud the Board of Education. This is apparently that we have really worked hard on effectiveness, and we have established a policy committee who has worked really hard. So I'd like to thank policy committee members Rich Olichinek and Greg Scapolato for all their hard work, and for board members who've attended the policy committee meetings and given shared your perspective. And to our board attorney and Dr. Bine and all the administrators who have been attending our policy meetings, we have truly spent a lot of time on our policies, and as far as effective governance goes, which is as our goal is to be a high-functioning board, and we have spent a lot of time on policy review. So I truly applaud our board for all the hard work, and thank the District 25 team for all their support in making sure that our policies are effective and up to date. So on that note, we will move forward to community input, our second community input. If you wish to address any item on the agenda, please complete one of the forms provided and hand the card to Lana. Lana, do you have any from us? Thank you, sir. Okay, thank you. Our first speaker, Mr. William Woodrow, if you could join us again, thank you.
Just a couple of questions. Get my 3 minutes. I attended like the presentation four times, and I noted when we were at the Village of Arlington Heights, the request was for 4 classrooms at Dryden. Now up here, when I looked at the presentation, you're now only going to build 3. Also, at the original presentation, Patton wasn't going to have a gymnasium. It seems like we're adding and subtracting things willy-nilly. And one of the questions that I asked in my email was, to me, if you were approved to build four classrooms and no gymnasium at Dryden and no gymnasium at Patton, then you're making changes is impacting the approval. And therefore, I think you need to go back to the village and get approval. Otherwise, I think you may be subject to litigation. That's number one. Number two, you're going to open up all these bids. I'm assuming there's going to be 43 different contractors bidding on this. You're going to open it up on May 5th. I think your next meeting is, what, the 9th? Is there going to be any input by the community, the people who are actually going to be paying for this, to have input into which bids or what's going into this? Because I know that at one of the meetings that Ms. Malik was at, she was in a panic when I asked that the storm drainage be made bigger to encompass the previous flooding and the conditions that were at the other at the Dryden 2007-2008. So you've created a problem, you're going to exacerbate a problem, and you're not going to go back because of the cost, because you don't have to with the stormwater. Also, one of the things that I forgot to mention is that as far as the construction and the capital upgrade, I noticed that you say that $34 million is going to be part of the bonds, but what you didn't say, and you had to figure this out, is you're only funding four of the 5 years for the capital in the bond and not the full 5 years. You're going to be getting it out of your own reserves, I guess. So this $60 million, and I remember Ms. Malik saying that, well, you know, this other $15 million, we can get to that in 3 years. Well, in 3 years, you're going to go for the $15 million because you're going to have to, because inflation is such that your original projections are probably going to be 20 to 25% greater than what they once were. And also, what was kind of interesting, you have a 19-to-1 student-teacher ratio. Dryden opened in 1952, 322 students, 9 classrooms. Student-teacher ratio was 36-to-1. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you, Mr. Bedro. Mr. Berg, Roger Berg. Welcome.
I trust all of you are aware of the House Bill 2789 that has passed, probably going to be passed by the Senate. A lot of this has to do with some of the comments made earlier and in preceding meetings about what would not be suitable in libraries. This bill, should it pass, and it will, is going to be monumentous. You're going to have to be working with other libraries. You're going to have to be working internally. I checked with the Arlington Heights Library, and there's nothing going on between the school districts and the library. There's no sharing of books. So if a student wanted to find the origins of a species, and it's not in the library, they could easily go to perhaps the Arlington Library and see if it's shared. At this point, is that being done? I don't know. It should be done. You should start preparing for this. It's coming. I strongly recommend you send information on a mailer to the entire district to say what repercussions this can have for the schools, the libraries, both the school libraries and the public libraries, so they are aware. They are aware that some of these things, as a school board, you may not have under your control unless you will lose significant funding. Make that clear. Make them understand. Be forthcoming with the information. So when it comes, you're not jumping, you're prepared. And I don't know if that's being done. Again, a direct mail to everyone in the district answering some of these questions. And just a final comment. At one of the meetings, I had heard that the libraries in the district are public. That might be stretching it. Could I go into a school and say, I want to walk into one of your libraries? I'd have to have a photo ID. I'd have to pass the principal, probably assistant principal, and perhaps even see if the librarian can make time for me. That is a strong stretch of what a public institution is. So thank you, but please, the bill is coming. Let's start getting ready for it now.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. certainly be fine. Thank you, Mr. Morgan. I'm glad you left your email so we can communicate, follow up with you. Okay, we are going to now, no more slips, right, Lena? Not seeing any. So future agenda items and topics with dates to be determined, Dr. Bynum?
So those remain. Again, upcoming, the student achievement and assessment update following spring assessment. We have completed the state spring assessment. We're currently doing MAP test right now. A ruler update presentation in May. This is a change. We were doing looking to do a combined board meeting with the Arlington Heights Park District. They are still very interested in that, as are we, but that we need to find a new date for that.
Okay.
Everyone's free for the
No, that's in the afternoon, right?
Yeah.
Yes. There'll be likely a special board meeting in the morning, and then it could move on to that rolling straw.
Thanks, Scott. I like Scott's student advocacy. We appreciate that, Scott. And new topics, Dr. Bynum?
Sorry, Madam President.
Oh, yes,
before
sorry.
We left, just real quick. So, Brian, was this, like this list, you were asking maybe to differentiate some of these items between the first and second meeting on the calendar? Is that, I just want to make sure.
No, just the general topics that were covered in the meetings.
Oh,
we have two in 1 month.
Sorry, I didn't say what I was referring to. The general board meeting topics under topics
with
dates.
Like the attachment that's on here is what you're referencing.
Yes.
I can also pull that together to show what's typically first and second, and what ones we've typically canceled, so you could weigh all that information.
Thank you.
What's in store for new topics for us?
I have not received any requests recently.
Okay. Great. And again, I encourage the board, if you have new topics, run them by Dr. Bynum. And so Dr. Bynum and I can touch base on those. And then, you know, we always want to be open to those. Okay, we are now I need a motion to adjourn to go back into closed session. If I could have that motion, please.
And I'll just add quickly that all of the topics for closed session are the same as the original closed session.
Okay. Thank you. So can I have a motion
Madam President,
go back into closed session?
I move we go back into closed session.
Okay. Thank you, Scott. And a second. Thank you, Chad. Lana, could you please call the roll?
Philippak?
Yes.
Conley?
Here.
Cerniglia?
Yes.
Jogi?
Yes.
Scott Bellotto?
Yes.
Okay, great. Thank you. We'll go back into closed session. Everybody, thank you so much for coming this evening. It was really good to see you.